Good afternoon, church.
Good afternoon.
I am normally up by 11:30 the latest, but I can see that at Agape, we are a people of not time, but eternity. You like me. I don't watch the time. I'm concerned with eternity. And so, my message, I am hoping, will be concluded in time for AY. Amen, church? Hallelujah. You have the nerves to endorse me by saying amen. It is good to be here.
Amen.
It's good to be in God's sanctuary. One more Sabbath, what do you say?
Amen.
I must say, first of all, Pathfinders, you are looking so cute in your suits. Wonderful. Amen, church, can you say amen?
Amen.
By the way, I don't charge GST for saying amen. And praise the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, that sounds a little better. It's all 0%. I want to say thanks to Pastor Johnson. What a man. You know, sometimes you meet some people in this life and you never hit it off with them, but there are others, you meet them and you just hit it off. Do you know what I mean? I met Pastor Johnson. I've always been hearing about Agape Church, how nice it is. And I was wondering if I would ever get an opportunity to speak here. And lo and behold, I met Pastor Johnson as I work as a Bible worker in the recently concluded crusade at Global Kingdom. And as we spoke together, we realize that we go way back. We were able to establish that we share some of the same roots. Yes, and I'm going to say it because I'm not afraid of where I am coming from. I was born and grown and raised in a place called Jonestown, Woodrow Street, right next to Trench Town. But good things come out of Jonestown. Amen. So I'm not afraid of where I'm from. Because God has good things from every walks of life and good people. What do you say? But I will not waste any more time. I just want to say thank you, Pastor Johnson, for allowing me and for taking, you know, my teacher at college said, if people are foolish enough to ask you to preach, you must be foolish enough to accept and preach. I want to get into my message. The message that I'm about to share with you today, as a matter of fact, I was prepared to preach somewhere else, and I had a message prepared, but I woke up one morning, I think it was Thursday morning, after I got the call, and the Lord laid on my heart a different message, so I had to discard that one and prepare the one that God wanted me to preach, which I believe will be a timely message. And so I ask of you for your attention. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. My message is taken from Esther chapter 3, verse 1 to 6. I'm not going to read it again in light of the time. We're pressed for time. Well, maybe not me, but you are. Esther chapter 3, 1 to 6, it was read already, so I will not read it again. But my topic is, death before. Did you all look at the brochure? Let's try that again. Death before. Death before. Dishonor. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, light divine, shine upon this heart of mine. Bathe my trembling heart and brow. Fill us with your Spirit. Come and fill us now. In Jesus' name. Amen. We are all involved in a spiritual warfare. We're all involved in a spiritual battle between good and evil, between God and the devil, between God's children and the devil's children, between truth and error, between true worship and false worship. And it will continue until Jesus returns. Are you with me, church? It is not a physical war, but it is a spiritual war. What kind of war? Spiritual war. We must be constantly reminded that we are in spiritual warfare. Satan will use every means necessary to cause us to rob God of the worship that is due unto his name. As we will see in this message, so I want you to stay focused on what I'm about to share. I am about to share a message that has to do with the last days. So, if I put you to sleep, then I'm responsible for waking you up. Amen? So don't worry, I will personally wake you up if I see you sleeping. I will ask your neighbor to wake you up if I can reach to you. Amen, church? I will tell everyone the color shirt you're wearing or the color dress you're wearing, what aisle you're sitting in, so don't sleep on me, because this is not bedtime story. So stay awake, stay focused. Amen? Lord, I need you to amen, son. Amen, church? Amen. Amen. Pastor, only they're hungry. There are four passages in the Bible that gives us an insight of the battle between the forces of good and the forces of evil as it relates to loyalty to God. They are found in the book of Esther, all chapters, and in the book of Daniel, chapter 3 and chapter 6, emphasis. And the final book, the book of Revelation, especially chapter 13 and 14, which is for us in the last days. In Esther chapter 3, Haman plotted to have Mordecai and all the Jews annihilated because they dared to be different and because they refused to bow to a mere man. They refused to break the second commandment of God, which forbids worshiping idols or images, which forbids bowing down to anyone or anything on this earth. The only one the Bible says that we should bow down to is the true and the living God. Can you say amen? God alone is worthy of our worship. God alone is worthy of our homage. God alone is worthy to receive praise and honor and glory and adoration. No man, no woman, no priest, no pope, no state official is worthy. Jesus alone is worthy to receive praise.
Amen.
So Mordecai refused to bow to Haman. That's problem number one. Because Mordecai was a Jew. The Jew were God's people. The Jew knew the Ten Commandments. Are you with me? So we have a problem. And as we encounter that problem, Mordecai heard that there was a decree to get rid of all Jews. And so when Esther heard it, and when the people heard of the decree to kill them all, the Bible says that they were mourning, they were crying, they were weeping and wailing. Because there was a sentence of death passed upon all Jews. That's strongly in the camp. But I'm glad today to know that there is somebody to whom we can run when there is a problem. What do you say? The Bible says that the people of God got together and they decided to petition God's throne on behalf of the people. They spoke to Esther. And Esther decided to take a risk and to go and have a talk with a person, the king, who makes this law. And the Bible tells us that as Esther made her way, she said one sentence that we must all remember. She said, "I'm going to see the king. It's a risk that I'm taking, but I am going in the name of Jesus. If I perish, I perish. But I'm going in to have a talk with the king." What do you say? And so she asked them to do something for her. She said to them, "I want you to fast for 3 days. Fast for me and fast for the people." And she called a fast for all the Jews who were facing extinction. And God had a way of turning things around. I don't think you hear me. I say, God, when we pray, have a way of turning things around. For the Bible tells me that as soon as they fasted and prayed, God worked it out. And eventually, I'm not going to go into the old details, but eventually, the same man, Haman, he had set up a gallows to hang Mordecai. And the Bible tells me that as a result of that, Haman ended up on the same gallows that he set up for God's people. We ought to be careful or we touch the anointed of God. And I thank God for prayer. What do you say? I thank God for fasting and for praying. Because when we fast and pray, we are not fighting with spirit, with a physical weapon. We are fighting with the weapon of prayer. We are fighting our battles. Because we don't fight with swords and shields and guns and knives. We fight our battles with this. Our needs. And if only we as a people of God would learn to know that when you have a problem, the first place you go is not to your neighbor. The first place to go is not to even your spouse. The first person to take it to. We all need to know paying dearly for the mistake of trying to execute God's people. The second scenario is about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, the bad Negro. Problem number one, the image was set up for them to fall down and worship it. Commandment number two, again, Satan is always, he never gives up, he's always under the attack, on the attack. So the image of gold was set up, and they were required to, these are Jews now who were held captive in Babylon, and there were thousands of them. It's not only three. Hello, somebody. Somebody's sleeping at me, she's wearing green. That's a clue. The Bible says that, is she awoke? Alright? The Bible says that they require everybody to fall down and worship this image that Nebuchadnezzar set up on the plain of Dura. And if you don't worship the image, you will be killed. And it was no ordinary death. It was to be a fiery death. So the Bible tells us, Nebuchadnezzar said, people, when you hear the music, the soldier, the harp, and the sackbut, and all of that, when you hear the music, it's time to fall down and to worship the golden image under threat of death. And everybody began to bow because nobody wanted to die. Jews and Gentiles alike were bowing. But the Chaldeans, who were very observant, they noticed in the crowd there were three boys who decided they bowed. Come on now. The Chaldeans, as they watched, they noticed that these boys stood up when they should be bowing. The boys were identified, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Nebuchadnezzar was notified, and as he was notified, Nebuchadnezzar, just like Haman, he was angry because he wasn't getting worship for Mordecai. Nebuchadnezzar, the Bible says, he was enraged. He was wroth. He was angry. Nebuchadnezzar was steaming through his ears, his nose, and all other parts of him. He was fuming because there were three boys who dared to stand up against the wrong. And so he said to them, he called them up and said to them, is it true that you do not serve my God or worship the golden image? Is it true what I'm hearing? Then he said to them, let's see if it's true. We're going to try one more time. We're going to play the music one more time. And when you hear the music, it's time for you to bow or you burn. So Nebuchadnezzar says, get ready. For failure to do so will result in you being thrown in a fiery furnace. Anybody would like to be thrown in a fiery furnace? Let me see your hand. Nobody. But Nebuchadnezzar had the audacity to say to these boys who are standing for the true and the living God and for the commandments of God, he said, I will see which God is going to deliver you out of my hands. And I just like how they answer Nebuchadnezzar. They say, with respect, due respect, O king. You know, they were very mannerful. God's people must be manners there. Oh, amen, church. With due respect, O king, we have no need to answer you in this matter. You know what this means? This means the matter is settled in our hearts. Hello, somebody. This means that there's no room for debate like Clinton and Hillary. Hello, somebody. No negotiation when it comes to the Word of God. No surrender, no retreat. It's death before dishonor. And the boy says, Nebuchadnezzar, if you throw us in the fire, you see our God, whom we worship, our God is able. Lord have mercy, the wrong sermon for the wrong congregation. Let me try that again. I said, the boy said to Nebuchadnezzar, O king, our God, whom we worship, is able. Excited about God, nothing else will. Our God will deliver us out of your hands. That's the God we serve. And then he says, but if not? But before I go to the if not, I want you to do something. Touch your neighbor and say to them, who may be going through hell right now in your life, God is able. Touch them and say, God is able. Say, our God is able to deliver. Our God is able to heal. Our God is able to restore, to take care of our enemies, to provide for all of our needs. Our God is able. He's able to do exceptionally, exceedingly, above all that you may ask or think. God is able.
Amen.
And I'm not asking, I'm telling that God is able. Because I know what God can do. The fact that I stand here is a miracle. I know that God is able.
Amen.
So after they say, but if not? And we must serve God with that attitude. If God don't answer the prayer, if God don't give me the job, if God don't heal me, if not, I still will bow. I'm still going to serve my God. So that's the God we need to serve, and that's the faith we need to have. The but if not faith. If God don't do nothing, if I pray and nothing happen, I still will serve Him. Because I'm not serving for what he can give to me. I'm serving him because I love him and because he gave me life and because he's been good to me, what do you say? And because he's worthy. So he says, but if he chooses not to deliver, we still will not bow. Master guides, pathfinders, everybody, listen up. Saints and sinners alike. This is what church is all about. I wanted them listening to me. I want to have her like she wandering. At least wake up. Yes, you. Did you hear what I said? I want you to listen to this. This is what church is all about. This is what you're being trained for. It's not just about looking nice and cute. It's about developing a relationship with God, like Shadrach, like Meshach and Abednego, to stand for principles of righteousness. What do you say, church? It is about developing unshakable faith in the the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is not just about learning to tie some knots. Hello? It's not just about memorizing some scripture you don't know the God of the Bible. It's not about just dressing up and looking smart. It is about having a steadfast relationship with God. When everyone else is doing wrong, you must do the right. When all your friends are doing bad things, you must stand up and stand up for God and God's Ten Commandment principles. Stand up for what is right. Yes, they were thrown in the fire. Yes, they had to risk their lives. Yes, they were thrown in the furnace. So they were not just putting up a show. Hello, somebody. When they told the king, we will not bow, they meant it. In their heart, it was death before dishonoring God. They meant it. They were serious. This is no joke thing we're talking about. This was a matter of life and death. And God honored their faithfulness.
Amen.
As He always does. So it is with us today. Honor God in your life, and He will honor you. Stand up for God, and He will stand up for you. Be faithful to God, and He will fight your battles for you. Because the battle, this spiritual battle, is not yours, it's God's. So we must learn to fight with the Spirit and the power of God. Let me move over to scenario number three. I'm coming down. Some of you look happy now when I say coming down. You see it. Be my time. Scenario number three. This time, the attack was on Daniel. The attack was not on the second commandment that forbids images. The attack was on the first one that says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. Are you with me, church? So the problem again is over the commandments of God and the worship of God. Daniel chapter 6 verse 4, listen this, listen. It says, in 6 verse 4 it says that they tried to find fault with Daniel, but there was no fault they could find with this man. Do you know when you are different? When you are trying to serve God, people will be extremely critical of you. Hello, somebody. People will always be watching you and chatting you. I mean, talking about you. They are listening to every word you say. They are watching every move you make. When you're a child of God, they're watching you. They're critical. We as Christians get the more scrutiny than anybody else. Did you know that? They scrutinize you in the workplace. You call yourself Christian and look where you are. You eat the pork. You call yourself Seventh-day Adventist and you're drinking wine. I saw you at the Christmas party last year. They love to watch us to point out our faults and failures. So verse 5 says, so they said, since we can find no fault in him, let us find fault with him concerning obedience to the law of God. I didn't say the Bible says this. Satan is always attacking God's law. Did you hear me, church?
Yes.
Satan is always attacking God's law and God's people. Once again, they tried to use the government of the day to make a decree that whoever petitions any god within 31 days a month shall be cast into a den of lions. Do you notice something we hear in the pattern? If you decide to obey God, you're threatened with death. I'm coming to a point, so watch me now. It says here that they will throw you into a lion's den. Anybody here would want to be thrown in the lion's den to be eaten by lions? No, all of us want to fall asleep and die peacefully. When I was a child, I saw everybody want to die peacefully. I just want to go sleep and don't wake up. Nobody wants to be threatened that they're going to be thrown in a lion's den. Are you in the church? But they threatened Daniel and said, if you worship God, then you will be thrown in the lion's den. The death penalty was passed, was issued. It was aimed directly at Daniel, but more so is God. What did I say we're doing? We're fighting a spiritual battle. In a church, we are in a spiritual warfare. Verse 10 says, even though Daniel knew about the threat and the penalty, that did not stop Daniel from praying. Hallelujah. The Bible says in verse 10, he went home, listen up now, he went home, went in his upper room. Do you have an upper room? He went in his upper room and he opened the windows wide open that everybody could see him. He wasn't hiding. This was bold defiance, Pastor Johnson, against man-made laws. Daniel was no chicken. He was a warrior for God. I hear anything over there, interesting. Daniel was no chicken. He was a warrior for God. Hallelujah. He was not hiding. The problem today in ministry, in the church of God, is that we have become cowards to preach the word of God. Oh, it is to be preaching. We have watered down the Advent message because we are afraid to offend people. We are afraid to get in trouble. We are afraid they will lock us down. And so the word of God is preached to pump up and to pull up. And many of us are preaching pure Baptist messages. And the straight testimony is watered down. We are afraid to call sin by its right name. We're facing some challenges, but not sin. We're facing some weaknesses, but not sin. We're facing some issues, but not sin. We have become too sophisticated because of our degrees and qualification and our status in the church. I want to tell you something. When you preach God's word, what is to be preached, you will be persecuted. You go back in the book of Acts and read it. The gospel, the Bible didn't come here just like that. It came through the blood of the martyrs. When they preached Jesus, they told them, they're preaching this way because we'll kill you. And they dared to defy the men of the day, the laws of the day. And those men preached the word of God. That's why today we can have the gospel. Let me move on. The final scenario. The book of Revelation. The book of Revelation is for us. Just before Jesus returns, God's people will once again be put to the test. Like Mordecai and the Jews, like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, like Daniel, the book of Revelation makes it clear that the final showdown between good and evil will be over worship. Worship. Revelation 14:7 proof text. Revelation 14:7 is a call to worship Him, that's God, who made heaven, that's God, and earth, and the sea, and the springs of water. This is a clear call to worship the true and the living God. This is a call to worship the Creator. Hello, somebody. On His blessed day, on His test day, on His rest day, on Saturday, not Sunday. Look at the response. Somebody is so like the first to hear this message. God's Sabbath still stands today. I say God's Sabbath is still relevant in the 21st century. Yeah. It still echoes from eternity. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shall you labor and do all your work, but the seventh day, not Sunday, Saturday, is the Sabbath of the Lord your God. Take that to the bank, or take it to your pastor. It's my Bible, I'm preaching. What do you say? In verse 9 of Revelation 14, there is a warning against false worship. There is a what? There is a what? A warning against false worship. The Bible says, listen, if any man worship the beast and his image, you hear the word again? You hear the word again, image. What did they set up for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? What was it? An image. If any man worship the beast in his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, he will receive the wrath of God poured out in full strength. You will have no rest day or night if you worship or accept the mark of the beast, which is upon us. But if you are keeping God's Ten Commandments, you will not receive the mark of the beast. That's what verse 12 says. It says, here is the patience of the saints, here are those who keep the commandments of God. So on one hand you have people who are worshiping the beast, on the other hand you have people who are keeping God's commandments. So if you're a commandment keeping person, you cannot receive the mark of the beast. According to Revelation 12 verse 17, about what will happen when you decide, like Daniel and Mordecai and Shadrach and Meshach and Abednego, what will happen? The Bible tells us, Revelation 12 verse 17, the dragon. Who is the dragon? Satan. The dragon was angry and raged with the woman, the church, with the people of God, and went to make war with us. The same way that Haman was angry with Mordecai, the same way that Nebuchadnezzar was enraged and angry, the same way that Daniel got thrown in the den of lions because he refused to break the first commandment that says, thou shalt have no other gods before me. So Mordecai and the Jews were threatened with death. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was threatened with death. Daniel was threatened with death. In the last days, God's people will be threatened not only that you won't be able to buy or sell, pay your mortgage, feed your kids. You think the Bible give bedtime story? This is real thing. Some of you don't even
to Baal. So, Bible says in Revelation 13, 14 and 15, read it. Read it. Listen, I'm going to read it. And he deceived those who dwell on the earth. He did what? Deceived those who dwell on the earth. Telling those who dwell on the earth that they should make an image of the beast, and that the image of the beast should both speak and cause as many as would not worship the image of the beast must be what? Must be killed. He caused it all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark on his right hand or in their forehead, and that no one might buy or sell except those who have the mark of the beast or the number of his name. Let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. I stepped away from my notes. Did you know that today's technology allow mankind to track you, monitor you, listen when you think that the phone is off, they're hearing you, duh. Today's technology, they have the means. And if you notice, a lot of these devices that are coming out now is to warm us up to being tracked. Let you get comfortable with it. On your phone, they can tell you exactly where your location is. They always want to know where you are. Hello, somebody. Yes. Then there are these Fitbits, things that you put at risk. The bankers are now telling you, the other day I went to Scotiabank, they're telling you, soon and very soon we'll have no more tellers. You can go to the machine. You can go online, because everything is now online, because they want to track and trace everything you do. The technology is here. When the Bible tells us that God, that John on the Isle of Patmos looked down in our 21st century and saw that man without the capability to rule the whole world. I remember one time I was driving a vehicle, working for a gentleman, and I was going east when I should be going west. God help me, tell me. Pastor, my phone rang. I answered, hello. Stephen. Yes, sir. Where are you going? Are you going east? You should be going west. I said, oh, you know that. All you stay in your office, sit in an office, and know where I am. Because they have a tracker in the vehicle. And soon and very soon, it will not just be in vehicles, they are placing trackers on cats, on rats, on dogs, on puss, on mice, in rice. They are putting trackers in the new world order that we're going to be living in, that we're living in now. They want to know everything about you. Just recently, the CRA, for those of you who are hiding money offshore, you don't want government to know what you have, and you're putting it offshore. The CRA says, we're going to soon track you down. Because all banks are now coming under one order. And they say if you have $10,000 in your account, they're going to charge you for tax evasion. So all you rich, nice, beautiful looking people who have money offshore, watch what you're doing. They're coming after you. Because it's one order now. Satan has given man the ability. That's why God in the Garden of Eden says, you shall be as God, and have become like God, able to track you down, and able to tell you where you are, and soon, even the schools they're having, like right now, Pastor, they're telling me, when your son is not coming to school, don't call us. Go online. Everything is online. Our whole life is online. Because you see, once you're online, they can tell everything about you. They can Google. All some of us have everything on Mr. Google control our lives. Mr. Google can tell you what you have been searching for. When you go to the court, God help you if you have a case in the court, because all they need to do is go to your email. An email will tell them everything, every site, everybody that you talk to. They can go on Facebook. I know what your face look like. We're almost there. But let me wrap up by saying, regardless of whatever threat man may make, I'm standing with God.
Amen.
We must not bow. We will not bow. We will not pay homage to no man, no government, no institution, no image. God's people must have one motto for these last days: death before dishonor. What do you say? Like Esther, we must say, if I perish, I perish. But I will not dishonor my king, my God. And finally, the same God. Oh, so many people walking up on earth. I am very sensitive when it comes to preaching. The same God who protected Mordecai from the gallows is the same God we serve today. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
The same God who stood with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in the fiery furnace, that not one hair of their head was singed, is the same God who will be with us in our tribulation. The God who dispatched his angel to shut the mouth of the lion, the hungry lion, is the same God who will deliver. For Daniel's God surely will deliver. The God who was with his people back then is the same God who I serve today. Daniel chapter 12 verse 1 says, at that time Michael shall stand up. All this while Michael, Jesus, has been sitting down. But the Bible tells me that when the tribulation comes, Michael, Jesus, not Michael Jordan, not Michael Jackson, but he's dead, but Michael, Jesus, will stand up to deliver his people. He will stand up for us. He will stand up, my Redeemer, my Restorer,
yeah,
my Protector, my Deliverer, my all in all. Is there somebody here who wants to stand for Jesus today?
Amen.
Let me see your hand. Praise the Lord. Stand up with me as we close. I'm going to invite Pastor Johnson up here with me. And we're going to sing the song, The Savior is Waiting. Some of you, you're a church goer, but you don't know Jesus. You got to know him like Mordecai did. You got to know him like Shadrach did to stand for him. You got to know him like Daniel to stand for him. Because this is a life and death matter when the time comes. Some of us are playing church. Some of us are just coming to church to look good on Sabbath. That's not what this is about. It's about a relationship with God. So today, if you are in the valley of decision, if you have not yet surrendered that heart to Jesus, if you don't know him from going to your upper room like Daniel, I encourage you to get to know him before it's too late. So if you're here,
not yet a member of this church. By the way, is there anybody here? You're just listening, you're not yet a member. I want you to give Satan a headache today. Just hold up your hand. If you're not a member, you're not a member of this church. Raise your hand. You're not a member. Not yet a member of this church. Is there any visitor here? Anybody who have not surrendered their life to Jesus? Is there one person here who has not yet given your life to Jesus? Just let me see your hand. I want to pray for you. Just one person. Just one. One for Jesus. Is there somebody here who has not yet given your life to the Lord? Is there somebody here who has not yet the Seventh-day Adventist? You're not yet keeping God's holy Sabbath, but you love the Lord. Let me see your hand. You love the Lord, you love, but you're not the Sabbath keeper. Let me see your hand. The Savior is waiting. As we sing this song, I ask of you, don't stay in your seat. Come. The Savior is calling you today. He's waiting to enter your heart. Don't be stubborn. Now is the time for you to be sealed. Now is the time for you to get to know who God is. If you wait, it may be too late. So as I say, as we sing, I know you're watching in time, that's why some of you won't watch. But I don't want to live in this service anymore. If you're here and you're not yet in a relationship with God, now is the time. Sing the song.
Think that we don't need prayer is the day where our soul is in trouble.
If you believe that you have it so well made that you don't need to come for prayer, something is wrong in your life. Because every one of us in the past, every one of us need prayer. All of us need prayer. So come for prayer. Please continue to sing as Pastor prays for us.
Let's remain standing for a closing.